Before we continue, I really want to give a big thank you to Andrew W. Mellon Foundation for their incredibly generous support of this closing keynote. Laurie Woolery is the Director of Public Works, an initiative at the Public Theater that seeks to engage the people of New York by making them creators and not just spectators. Working with partner organizations in all five boroughs, Public Works invites communities to join in the creation of ambitious works of participatory theater. Laurie Woolery is a director and a citizen artist. A first-generation Latinx, she works with theaters and communities to build sustainable art practices. She has developed and created and directed new works with populations ranging from incarcerated women to residents of a small Kansas town devastated by a tornado. She creates site-specific theater in locations such as a working sawmill, parking lots, prisons, and the banks of the Los Angeles River. She has worked at Oregon Shakespeare Festival, Yale Rep, Cornerstone Theater Company, and Los Angeles Philharmonic, among many others. She has directed world premieres of plays by Tanya Saracho, Mary Kathryn Nagle, Charise Castro Smith, Marisela Trevino Orta, and many, many more. Please join me in welcoming our closing keynote, the amazing Laurie Woolery.
Yes. I'm short too, so hopefully people can see. Thank you for inviting me. I'm happy to be here. I want to say that I believe in community. When a group of humans come together, no matter their disparate backgrounds, ages, ethnicities, or occupations, and they share a purpose that can only be achieved by working together, and that purpose is rooted in a deep set of values, then magic happens. And I've seen it happen over and over and over again. The key is authentic partnerships, deep, longitudinal partnerships. And when those authentic partners are carefully nurtured with community members, then anything is possible. Community raised me. They have been my master teachers and mentors. Community has taught me everything I know about being a citizen artist in the world, and that mentorship continues. You see, I never thought I could actually live an artistic life. Actually, I didn't even know what that meant. I couldn't even dream what that looked like. It was too big of a dream for me, and a dream that others got to have, but not me, and not people in my community. I remember learning that lesson early. I was little, probably 5 or 6, and I was sitting on the couch helping my mother fold laundry. The TV was on and some program was playing. And I remember seeing people singing and dancing and telling stories. And those stories gave me a glimpse into another world. Stories that lifted me right off that couch, out of that living room, and I was hooked. I looked at my mom and I said, "That's what I want to do." And she said, "Ay, no, mija, our people, we don't get to do that." So I accepted it as truth. My mother never joked around. But something inside me asked, why? I'm a first generation daughter of immigrants and dirt farmers. I was raised with a strong work ethic and a pragmatic sense of duty. I was taught to work hard, put family first, and contribute to my community, plus try to buy a house and maybe get health insurance. So according to my family, being a storyteller did not seem like a good use of my time. It was a hobby for the wealthy, so no, real work had to be done. So put that desire away, I did what was expected of me, and got to work. But what I saw in those early years was injustice and division, and I witnessed profound loneliness that creates. I wanted to know people's stories, and I was curious, and I just didn't want people to feel so alone in the world. Then disruption happened within my family, and from the rubble of my broken home, something emerged. It was like all bets were off and I could make my own rules. That hidden why suddenly like leapt forward, and I knew I needed to salvage something out of this personal chaos. So I took the skills my family taught me, and I decided to do something to unify those feeling excluded, abandoned, or othered. I'm a theatrical dirt farmer. I go into communities, planting creative seeds and providing sustainable tools to nurture artistic, civic engagement, and cultural transformation. That is a mouthful, I do know that. But I finally can articulate what it is that I do by partnering the values my family taught me with this desire to be creative. I could honor both. We all know that art cultivates and strengthens our capacity for empathy by building bridges between our perceived differences and connecting us to a shared humanity. So it was through this empathy that I started building a practice, activating it within myself first, while I was doing it with others. It started for me when I volunteered at South Coast Repertory in Costa Mesa, California. I was new to this whole artistic, acting, creative thing, but I offered to, you know, bring acting classes into the neighborhood for kids who could not afford the regular classes. I understood that. I felt like I had something to contribute. My mentor, Jose Cruz Gonzalez, and I went out into the community, a community center in Santa Ana, and we hoped 20 kids would show up. 120 kids did. Immediately, I was like, oh my gosh, what are we gonna do? We're gonna have to turn away 100 kids. And Jose was like, wait, give me a minute. Okay, this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna divide them in half. You're gonna take half, I'm gonna take half. We're gonna reduce them. And I'm like, wait, I'm not a teacher. I'm not a teaching artist. And he said, listen, you know more than they do. You are a teacher now. So what I learned in that moment, in that single moment, changed the course of everything for me. You gotta be flexible. You gotta be open because plans change. Equity, there is always room at the table. Everyone is welcome. Say yes. Make do with the resources that you have because there is always a solution. And fear is an amazing motivator. From that moment, the Neighborhood Conservatory was born and for over 30 years has provided classes in communities and offered full scholarships for youth who cannot actually afford the conservatory at South Coast Repertory. During my time with Cornerstone Theater Company, I directed a play at Blue Ox Mill Works in Eureka, California in Humboldt County. We explored what it means to walk a hero's journey with veterans, homeless youth, and people with special needs by creating a site-specific piece within that functioning wood mill. Today, it remains a thriving theater company, having recently created their own play, Radio Man, with veterans. While in residency with the 24th Street Theater, I worked with immigrant parents in the North Park neighborhood of South Central Los Angeles. Although their children were taking classes at the theater, there was no programming for them, so Teatro del Pueblo was born. We worked together to create a bilingual holiday play that ended with the audience participating in a community posada as we marched and sang through their own neighborhood. Today, that ensemble of parents still gather together and perform an annual holiday play. While working at the California Institution for Women in Chino, California, I held these writing workshops for the women while we were creating a cornerstone play for all time that explored the complicated topic of punishment and retribution. Afterwards, the women created New Dawn Players so they could continue to write and share their stories as a way to heal and build community. And then I returned to my mother's homeland in San Julian, El Salvador, and worked with local teens creating Sueño Inconcluso, Unfinished Dreams, because they wanted to reflect their transnational experience and tour it out to the neighboring towns and communities. I cite these specific examples of community collaboration because they reflect how partnership can be created, whether you are a solo artist or within an artistic institution. They also reflect that people are hungry for community. People are hungry for a venue in order to be creative and share their stories and have those stories reflected. So why partnerships? Why community partnerships? It's a great question. So I like to answer that question with another question. What would it be like if our institutions were more like community centers instead of country clubs? I'm the director of public works at the Public Theater in New York, and we believe art is the birthright of all people and are constantly looking for ways to break down the perception of who gets to be an artist. By democratizing who has access and who gets to participate, we are shifting the practice of theater being a commodity back into a set of relationships. Our goal is for community to be at the heart of every theater, and theater at the heart of every community. We do that through longitudinal partnerships. We start by asking, who is your community? For us, it was looking to gather together a group of humans who truly reflected New York City in all its rich diversity. We wanted to see ages and ethnicities. We wanted all five boroughs represented and to work with organizations that did not already have a thriving creative practice. We wanted to share our resources with those who did not already have access. So I just want to call into the room our partners at Public Works. Currently, we are working with Brownsville Recreation Center in Brooklyn, where we are working with seniors. They have been partners with us for all 8 years. The Fortune Society in Queens, working with men and women with justice histories. They have been with us for 8 years. Dream Yard in the Bronx, working with parents of children within their arts and education program. They have been with us for all 8 years. The Military Resilience Foundation, working with veterans from all wars. They are entering year four with us. The Center for Family Life in Sunset Park in Brooklyn, working with intergenerational families. Four languages are spoken in that class, and they are starting their fourth year with us as well. Domestic Workers United, a workers-led organization of Caribbean, Latinx, and African nannies, housekeepers, and caregivers. They have been with us for all 8 years. Children's Aid, working with their girls' choir. We have witnessed those girls grow up and graduate from college. They have been with us for all 8 years. And Casita Maria Center for Arts and Education in the Bronx. It starts with a 2 to 3 year commitment with our community partner organizations. We have seen the profound benefits of what happens when community is deeply invested over a period of years. People show up for people, not for institutions. If we thoughtfully build relationships over time, people realize that we're not abandoning them. And then the theater, now the public theater, is a part of their lives. Weekly acting classes have become a meaningful part of people's creative practice, and they bring family and friends to their theater to see plays, attend monthly potlucks, and participate in public works productions. This partnership must also be mutually beneficial. We look to find partners who can see that the theater skills that we are offering meet and serve their vision for themselves. We like to talk about it as mutual mentorship. We look to see how we both can grow together, because that is how trust is built. There also needs to be a willingness on our side as a theater program to change by this work, to be affected by it. Both institutionally and personally, we need to receive feedback and implement change. Otherwise, it will never be a welcoming and inclusive partnership. What we don't want to do is walk community in the front door and then abandon them once they are there as if all our work is done. At the public, we have shifted our security, front of house, stage management, ticketing practices from feedback we have received from our community. First year, community would show up and they would be asked why they were there. Now, our security knows them by name. All of this is done with the priority to open up access and truly make the public the people's theater. Partnerships must be authentic. So I ask people to really think, is community truly a part of your institutional mission? And if not, no harm, no foul, just go home. Our communities have been used to being hustled. They have been used to being asked for their economic dollars and can smell inauthenticity a mile away. We have been working to try to change that dynamic, and that is why longitudinal partnership is so important. Healthy partnerships are built on respect, trust, and mutuality. It has to be an authentic invitation filled with possibility, inclusion, and radical joy. You've got to really want to do it and do it right because it is so worth it. So I'm going to show you a brief video so you can hear directly from our public works community members.
Public Works is the public theater's attempt to make the boundary between artist and audience permeable.
The idea is to create ambitious works of participatory theater in collaboration with community partner organizations from all over the city.
Meaning that Public Works invites New York to come on stage and perform at the Delacorte Theater. To me, the perfect public works participant is someone who never imagined themselves on the stage at all.
The core idea is to embody the fact that everybody is an artist. It's part of what makes you a human being, and we need to change the theater from being a commodity back into a set of relationships among people, which is what it really is.
Hi, I'm Genesis, and I'm from the Bronx.
Hi, my name is Shannon, and I live in Harlem.
And I live in Queens, New York.
My name is Gia, and my home is Brooklyn, New York, and here with you guys.
It was an opportunity for me to do something that I didn't do as a younger person. I had no idea that I'd be doing this at this age.
Every summer, we host auditions and then rehearsals for a show in the park. But the summer show is a slice of a very big cake of our programming. It's really, if anything, the cherry on top.
Public Works offers free theater classes at each of our partner sites that are facilitated by master teaching artists. These classes are crafted around the goals and the interests of each of our communities.
The groups come from such different places. Brooklyn, the Bronx, Long Island. You have the military involved. You have kids' choruses involved.
We engage with our community 365 days of the year. So that by the time we're all gathered at the first potluck for the first rehearsal of the summer show, it's like a family reunion.
We got very excited about the idea of having the program be much more than any one show, because that word partnership is so, is the truest description of what it is that we're looking for. We're looking for an organization that sees within its own vision for itself a way that theater arts could complement what they're already doing. So it's sort of like, where can our set of tools and interests meet yours?
It's an ongoing thing that we have with the public theater. Getting people involved, if they have never read Shakespeare, exposing them to Shakespeare. How great is that?
And on foot we'll take my brother in Arden and put him to the sword.
There are people who have been doing the adult Shakespeare class for 4 or 5 years. And guess what? They're deeply trained Shakespearean actors now. So I think what I've seen is the depth that you get when you work with a community over time.
I grew up being part of Public Works. I started when I was 14. I see myself now as a different person than I was before. I'm more confident in myself and I'm more open, and it's allowing me to say yes and taking different opportunities.
Oh, my poor Rosalind, whither wilt thou go? Wilt thou change fathers? I will give thee mine. I charge thee, be not thy more grieved than I am.
I have more cause.
Thou hast not, cousin.
The Public Works has done a series of Shakespeare plays and one adaptation of Homer. And those plays all have themes of finding out who you are by traveling, by understanding yourself as part of a larger community.
We're often interested in either like a hero's journey or this idea of a hard-won joy. And through struggle and through overcoming obstacles and difficulty, joy can be found.
I was arrested on some uncurricular activities. Had I known about this earlier, I don't know where I'd be right now. It gave me a whole different outlook on life, period, you know.
We really have built what feels like an amazing family. I'm not originally from New York and don't have family here. Through Public Works, I have gained nieces, nephews, cousins, brothers, sisters, and even grandparents. And in the rehearsal room, that's when those relationships really start being built. So this year, during our first day of tech rehearsal, we experienced a lot of rain, and that was really a first.
That particular moment, I have to say, I've been doing this work for a really long time, close to 20 years, and I felt like the community held me up in that moment. You know, it's like I have 2.5 days of tech and one of them is being rained out. How are we possibly going to be able to direct this show? So all that chatter was going on in my head. And then I would look up and the community is in ponchos, dancing full commitment under the rain. To me, it was like, they taught me, they held me. People often say that, oh, this is so amazing what Public Works does for the community. And I try to explain to them it's really a reciprocal relationship. We may extend the invitation, but it's the community that takes it to a whole other level.
So, community as collaborator. Oh, thank you. They're pretty awesome. Community as collaborator. We've talked about community as partner. I have to say that I treat all my artistic partnerships in the exact same way, whether it's at a regional theater or out in community. I was asked the same questions. How do I build trust, openness, joy, and rigor into my collaborations? How can I be a good collaborator? How can I set everybody up for success? I strive to do this through practicing the following values: deep listening. If there is one thing the community has taught me, it is the value of deep, authentic listening. Not the kind of listening that you're waiting to insert your thought in, but that open-hearted, curious-to-learn kind of listening that is the cornerstone of any great collaboration. Bring all of yourself to the conversation and be ready to receive all your community has to share, especially when it pushes up against your preconceived ideas. Let their ideas test yours. Let their expertise inform yours. Trust me, it would only make the partnership, process, and production better. Don't enter the conversation assuming you have all the answers. Listening to our partners is how we learn to be relevant to what our community needs and wants. Equity. Understanding and providing whatever is necessary for each person to be successful and participate. Theater makers and arts administrators have a very clear idea of what VIP means. There's a hospitality we know that is connected when we say those three letters. Very important person. Especially when it comes to this notion of how we treat VIPs when they arrive at our theater. We know how to treat people and make them feel special. It's one of our secret powers that we have. So Public Works got very excited about what happens if we redefine the idea of who is a very important person. What happens if we redefine who is considered VIP in our institutions? What if we applied our skills in welcoming VIPs to all of our community members? So that's what we do. Respect is the foundation of the best collaborations I've experienced. If everyone in the room is heard, seen, and valued, then the room is alive and free to create something truly transcendent. However, if you enter a space in the role of bringing something versus building something, then the power dynamic is off from the start. Mutual mentorship is what real partnership looks like, an exchange of ideas and resources that collectively advance the mission of both organizations. Unity. You are not alone, and you don't need to know how to do it all because your partners are your collaborators. They are your biggest cheerleaders, and they are your most rigorous thought partners. Walk your talk. You gotta manifest that, and that is manifested in so many different ways with this work. Showing up when you say you're going to, returning phone calls promptly, being transparent, managing expectations, respecting participants' time, listening to communities' questions, concerns, and feedback. It is important to pay attention to the details, from the micro to the macro. We like to say clarity is kindness, so being really transparent about what we're taking on. And then manage the expectations on what we can actually do. And then be impeccable with your word. You have to deliver on the promise. You can't get so caught up and excited that you want to like promise the world and then not deliver. Community as muse. This is probably my favorite. I always think that Shakespeare, I don't think, we all know Shakespeare wrote for his time. So I think he's like the community artist out there in this mosh pit, like people just being viscerally affected by what he's saying. Art is made better by including community. I just know that for a fact. I believe it in my core, and I've seen it happen over and over again. When working with community, all of humanity is present in the work. It is an honor to be in relationship with all kinds of people. We need to reflect their stories on stage, through text, through the actors who are performing it, and the staff who is building it. We need to build teams with people that look like our community. Let community see themselves reflected in all aspects of the work, both on and off stage. Pay attention, because inspiration comes in all forms. This work allows us to celebrate the collective human spirit. And our cities and our communities are best when everybody has the opportunity to participate. And create something spectacular. Bring the same artistic ambition and rigor to the work you create with your community. People rise to the bar you set for them, so push yourself, push them, be rigorous. And put this work on the very best stages you have. Community deserves the very best. So I wanted to leave you with some tools for your toolbox so you can walk away with something. Honestly, so much of what we do can already be used in this work. It's not like we have to reinvent it. We just have to kind of widen the scope of who gets to be involved. So, get your colleagues involved. It's a program at the Public Theater, but get everyone involved. Invite them to potlucks, invite them to classes. Share information with your staff and invite other people to come in and build their own relationships with community. Ask within your institution, where does this community project live? Know people's names. Know their pronouns. Know how to correctly say and pronounce their first and their last names. I can't emphasize enough how important that is. It builds trust and is really kind of the one thing, if you can walk away with, I would say learn people's names. And then create a space that is warm, joyful, rigorous. Give people time to land when they're racing in from their lives. A moment for everyone to collectively breathe together and to celebrate the fact that they made it, even if it was 5, 10, 15, 20 minutes late. They got there. They made it a commitment. Feed people. Food is the great unifier, and provide them with excellent, healthy food. That has been a big shift for us. Know people's dietary needs and meet them. It's connected to that idea of VIP. And manage your time, honor their time, start on time, create a rigor in the work, and end on time. And when you are doing this work, make sure that the entire institution is sharing the same conversation, that we are describing this work in the same way. And one of our little checks is to describe community the way they would describe themselves. So we avoid words like at risk, underprivileged, underserved, minority, oppressed, disenfranchised, inner city. Listen to how they talk about themselves. My friend, love is in the details. And it transforms this work from community being outsiders to being a part of your institution. I believe in this work. I've seen it transform communities and artists and staff and audiences. It is a leap of faith, but it is a leap of faith so worth taking. It unifies theater, it makes it accessible to all, and it makes us relevant in the cities that we are serving. It's not easy, it can be messy. It might even feel a little scary, but at times it might break your heart a little bit, but break it open in a really great way. From being somebody who did not think that I could participate, that I wasn't invited to the party, to be able to have the honor of creating space to not only invite, but to honor community, is such a beautiful gift. And I want you all to have that gift. Community teaches us how to walk with love, how to sit in a room and not have the answers. Community teaches us how to listen, to truly listen with an open heart, even when we might feel a little challenged. Public theater is filled with a bunch of, I would like to say, like A-plus students. Everyone wants to get it right. And community allows us to be a little messier that way. It's not about getting it right. It's about being authentic. So, I know that when we all sit together, and when we sit together respectfully, and we listen to one another with an open heart, the great work begins. From play to play, from town to town, city to city, person to person, institution to institution, this work is transforming individuals, communities, and the field. I've seen it, I've experienced it, and I forever have been altered by it. Change is inevitable, transformation is a choice, and there is no partner I would rather be walking this journey with than community. So I'm gonna leave you with a 3-minute video. You saw them rehearsing the show. There are gonna be 160 people on stage doing a scene from As You Like It. Our youngest is 5 years old. Our oldest is 82 years old. Sonia Tyatt is our choreographer. It is a rigorous piece, it is a joyful piece, and it is a piece that I think really signifies what we try to accomplish at Public Works. It's the scene where Duke Sr. has been banished, and he is welcoming all those who have been banished by his brother Duke Frederick into Arden, a place where all are welcome. So, enjoy.
How shall we learn to be? How shall we learn to be? How shall we learn to be? child. Gather around as we make a song. How shall we sing of grace in this strange place? I don't know, but I'll sing along.
Enlarge.
We shall try to find the use of our distress.
Enlarge.
We shall answer to adversity with kindness.
Enlarge.
We shall seek the blessings in our miseries.
We shall learn to see the forest for the trees.
Oh, when the icy winter lifted up my body, even though I shiver, I'm still alive. I smile and thank the wind for its honesty. Remind my skin it's thick enough to survive.
In art,
we shall study all the sermons in the stones.
In art,
we shall hear the language of our hearts and bones.
In art,
we shall read the book in the broken sacred spring. We shall listen for the truth in everything.
Actually thinking, feeling creatures who lived here long before we came. And when we occupy their native home and hunt them down, we're no better than your brother who displaced us just the same.
Oh, Jaques, it does irk me. The poor dappled fools should in their own confines have their round haunches gored.
No, but the deer themselves are just as bad as we are. I recently saw one with an arrow in his heart on his dying breath. And when the other deer went by, they just ignored their wounded kin, deliberately leaving her to a cold and lonely death. And another thing, wait, I lost my train of thought.
Jaques, I love to cope with you in these sullen fits, for you are full of matter. Everybody, two, three, four.
In art.
We shall find out what we're made of from the rain.
In art.
We shall find we're made of selfishness and pain.
In art.
We shall search for harmony in every turn.
We shall make the same mistakes and never learn.
Finally, Jaques.
In art.
We shall unify.
In art.
We shall all soon die.
In art.
We shall pitch a tent.
We shall ruin the environment.
In art. We shall reach out in the darkness and the rise. In art. We shall see the light within each other's eyes. In art. We shall make a sanctuary all as one.
Shepherd and our son.
Till it burns out and kills us all.
Together we'll heal our wounds. Together we'll heal.
So I'm being transparent. Is there time for questions? Is that right? Yeah. Am I doing that right? Okay. Okay. There's a microphone right there if anybody has any questions they want to ask. So sorry, I'm going to make you work for it.
So many of us in this room we're in the marketing departments, and you know, we're in those kind of levels. And I just wanted to get your advice of how we have these conversations to the people that can help us affect these changes within our own communities. What do we need to do to affect things like this?
I think we love our marketing department and our development department, and we work really closely with them in terms of figuring out how we share the same story, you know? So we have our meetings and we jam on it. I don't even know if there's anybody from the public theater here, but I think it's really understanding what it is that we do, what we're trying to take on, and also having a relationship with community, because I think that when you have that personal relationship, you're able to understand how it is to talk about something. You know, I think that we try really hard for it to not be about a social service or something that we are doing. Like, we are just creating really great art. So it's like any other play or any other exhibition that you would have within your institution. Like, let's have a conversation about what the goals are, what the focus is, and really, I would say, partner with your whoever is doing this work within your institution. I don't know if that's helpful, but I think we really, the way we engage in our community with partnerships, we try to walk that same talk within our institution as well. So it's not like we are being kumbaya and great with our community and then inside we're like fighting. Like, we really try to understand what our marketing departments and our development department is up against. And Alex Tanetta and Kristen Gongora have been incredibly helpful there in our, in our development department to help us form language around how to talk about this work to funders. Because it's complicated, because people go, oh, it's community, and they think it's lesser than. And it's like, no. I mean, it's why I wanted to show these pieces, because, and it's even sometimes hard when you're watching the video, when you come to witness a show, it is a conversation that is happening between, like all great artists, the art and the community. So there, we see what's happening in the people who are sitting in the audience are our community members, because people come and see the show to support their families. And so, I mean, it's really easy. Like, it's hard to get tickets, so it's really easy to get rid of the tickets, and they're all free. So that's also the other aspect of this work. So I don't know if that helped. Hi.
Okay. Hi. I think I might be asking for a cheat sheet, but do you have like a step-by-step guide on how you begin this process to engage folk from maybe a two-year span to pull it all together, or a one-year span? We do our marketing, we do our auditions, mm-hmm. we engage the community like this. I'm sorry, I need the baby's food.
Oh, no, not at all. No apologies whatsoever. I know I was trying to cram a lot in this idea of partnership and collaboration and muses. We actually, because we're 8 years old and we've been working with other institutions around the country, we have developed a playbook that we are piloting right now, because we're both building a program and trying to codify practices. And what worked in our first 3 years, we're discovering now in year eight, because we have, as Tim Lord said, we have trained Shakespearean actors in our community. So we are racing to keep up with them, because they are like, okay, bring on more. So we do, and we should actually talk afterwards. Yeah. If any of your institutions are interested in this work and wanting to either join us as partners or affiliates, we're sharing this work. We just want to share it with people so that people don't have to start from ground zero, that they can learn from our trial and error. So happy to have that conversation. Hi.
Hi, my name is Beth Prevor, and
Hi,
I run Hands On, and we have actually been working at the Public for 35 years, interpreting at Shakespeare in the Park, and now working downtown at the Public. I just want to just say thank you. I never really quite understood this idea of partnering as well as I actually do now. I mean, we're considered a partner of the Public, but having now worked with the Public more closely in the last couple of years in providing access, I feel part of the Public, and I feel like the Public is doing, they're walking the walk. I mean, they're not just talking, and that I just feel the authenticity in questioning and including the community and reaching out to the community for feedback and information. So anybody, and again, watching a video can't really express what it feels like to be in an audience of 2,000 mm-hmm. people and watching 200 people walk out on that stage, which is quite amazing. So I just want to say, in terms of like the community aspect of mm-hmm. it's reaching out to people in the communities who kind of know what they're talking about and bringing them in and listening. And I think that's the part that I'm feeling right now, is that I do feel I'm being respected as what I know it being included in the community. So what's happening now with the Public is it's public. It's I feel very included, and I've been watching deaf people coming now to the Public spaces. Mm-hmm. And they, I mean, Shakespeare in the Park, we've been doing Shakespeare in the Park for 35 right. years. We get hundreds of deaf people who fly in from around the country because it's such an event. And they feel that it's their theater, and they feel comfortable, and they feel accepted, and they feel part of that community. So what I'm feeling now downtown at the Public is that mm-hmm. same kind of feeling that everybody's involved and everybody is included. So I just want to say I applaud the Public. I am thrilled to be a part of. I am thrilled to be a partner. And I encourage everybody to listen to exactly what you said and make this a part of, start a program like that, because it's wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you. I also just want to add that I came from Cornerstone Theater Company, which is a smaller theater company in Los Angeles that its core mission is doing this kind of work. So when I first came to the Public, I was a little like, yeah, okay, institution, let's see, like, if you're really gonna walk your walk. So I really just came thinking like, let me see. Because I wanted to see how can this work live within the large artistic palaces in this country, because it can. And the good news is that Oscar is committed to it. And you know, we don't always get it right, but we admit when we get it wrong and we learn from that. So Public Works is one of our community engaged programs. And there's the mobile unit and there's Public Forum and some others as well. So, yes. Hi.
Hi. How are you?
Good.
Mark Smith from Sarasota, Florida. Hi. First, I wanted to thank you for your service to the craft. We really appreciate it. What you're doing.
Oh, thank
you. It's awesome.
I'm so lucky.
My question is, how do we? I represent a large institution, large museum institution, large brand. Mm-hmm. How do we get these large institutions to get past the revenue thing when it comes to the community, especially when you haven't had relationships with yeah. different groups in the community in the first place, and these same groups want to be a part of your institution, they want to do things at your right. institution, and as soon as there is an opportunity, we get back to, well, here's the fee. You know, how do we get past that language and build those authentic connections and relationships to allow these opportunities to thrive
right.
and to build on those relationships that will ultimately in the future, you know, be you know, a win-win for both organizations?
Yeah, it's a great, don't you wish I just had the answer? And I could just go, boom, mic drop. I think it's taking time, and I think we're all in it together. So that's one of the reasons why we did Public Works National, is we are working to build partners and a movement, and the Public Theater's development department is working with us so that we can, and working with all these partner organizations, so maybe we can change the focus of how it gets funded, so we're not forever stuck in this rut of we need to make money off ticket sales. You know, our institutions benefit so much by having programs that community is thriving in. So what I would love to say is like, we should have a conversation and hook you up with Alex and Kristen, because they're really leading that for us at the Public Theater, thinking about how we can change the nature of how this is talked about so we can actually get it funded so that people aren't having to worry about selling tickets. And I just realized our time ran out. So we should talk more. Oh, is that one more? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. Hi.
I'll try to be fast. Hi, my name is Naomi, and I'm new to the team of an institution that's been around for a while. We've been known as the World Erotic Art Museum. Now we're the Will Zig Museum Building. We're going to have multiple collections. And I'm wondering what your advice for, I'm sure everyone from the outside, our organizations are amazing. I came from the nonprofit space. Sometimes behind the scenes, there's a bit of dysfunction, especially, you know, sometimes when it comes to collaboration between teams.
We're
and because
human
I'm
beings.
New and I have ideas and I bring them to them, I'm wondering how do you get, you know, the internal community operating on the same page before you're even ready to reach out to the external?
The internal meaning our institutions.
Yeah, the staff, even if it's small.
Yeah, no, absolutely. We are building alliances and relationships within our departments by, it was addressing the question over here, is really, you know, talking to each department and finding out where their priorities lie and having and meeting that with where our priorities lie and actually having them build a relationship with community so that they can be influenced together. But I'm running out of time, right? Feeling the pressure. Let's talk afterwards. Can we do that? Great, thank you. Thank you very much.